Welcome everybody to our second session of the Touché workshop on content retrieval, which I'm happy to start, that we are happy to start with a keynote speaker, Anne Lauscher, who would be talking about theory-based argument quality in argument retrieval and will discuss opportunities and challenges. And a couple of words about Anne. Anne just recently started as a postdoctoral researcher in an NLP group at Bocconi University in Milan, and now she's working on introducing demographic factors into language processing systems, because she wants that the system performs better and also more fairly. Anne obtained her PhD at the University of Mannheim in Germany, where her research was focused on interplay between language representations and computational argumentation. And during her studies, she also interned and then became independent researcher at Grammarly and also at the Allen Institute for Artificial Intelligence. And she got publications at top tier conferences such as EMNLP, ACL, III, Calling, for which she also regularly serves as a program committee member and also as a reviewer and ethic reviewer. Well, this is my great pleasure to introduce Anne. So I'm stop sharing my screen.
Okay, and I think then I can take over and share my screen.
You can take over.
Okay, you should be able to see my screen now, right?
Yes, we see it.
Perfect. Yeah, thank you very much for the invitation. I'm very glad to be here today. And as you already said, I'm talking about advanced argument retrieval. And in argument retrieval, you have, as you know, a user given, you have a search engine, and then the user has a certain information need. For instance, why should we allow gay marriage? And what the user wants to see is then arguments which are retrieved. Yeah. And of course, the user does not want to see any argumentative texts, but really good arguments. And this term good here relates to the notion of argument quality. So argument retrieval should be guided by the quality of arguments. And within this workshop, the organizers of the Touché shared task on argument retrieval, they make already an attempt at defining what quality means. So here's the text from the evaluation. So they say that they have human assessors, which will label the retrieved documents, and in particular for their topical relevance and their rhetorical quality. So these are already two terms defining what good means, what quality means, and they go on in defining what rhetorical quality means by saying that, for instance, the document should contain arguments, it should have a good style, a proper sentence structure, and it should be easy to read, and so on and so on. And all these aspects which are mentioned in the description, they can be captured by certain terms, such as appropriateness, argumentativeness, and so on. And these terms, they really describe the aspects of the so-called theory-based notion of argument quality. And now I will explain to you what this is and what can be gained from it for advanced argument retrieval. So the notion of theory-based argument quality comes from Henning Wachsmut and colleagues, who is also right now in this call. So what they did was that they surveyed a whole bunch of literature, argumentation theoretic literature, more than 2000 years of theory about how to create a good argument. And they came up with a taxonomy describing the theory-based view on argument quality. And this taxonomy decomposes overall argument quality, which you can see here on the screen, into three properties which describe the logical, dialectical, and rhetorical dimension of argument quality. And these properties are cogency, reflecting the logical view, reasonableness for the dialectical view, and effectiveness, reflecting the rhetorical view. And the taxonomy further decomposes these perspectives into certain aspects. which you can see here. Yeah. And relating to the example from before, for instance, should we allow gay marriage? And there are a bunch of arguments that are good candidates for the retrieval engine. Then we can really assess the arguments with respect to these perspectives. So for instance, maybe there's an argument saying no, but then there are a lot of swear words. And this would then affect maybe the effectiveness dimension, the perceived effectiveness of the argument, and in particular, the appropriateness aspect. Maybe swear words are not appropriate in the particular context of the debate, but maybe the argument is still clear, maybe it is well arranged, and so on. And relating to the internal logical structure of arguments, we can look then at the cogency perspective. So here it's really about the microstructure of arguments. And for instance, in local relevance, the question is, are the premises given within this argument relevant for the particular claim made within the argument? And for locus sufficiency, we would ask, is the set of premises given as a whole sufficient for supporting the claim given in the argument? And on the other hand, if we look more at the dialectical perspective, this really reflects the quality of the argument within the overall controversy. So we would then maybe ask, is the argument as a whole globally relevant for solving the issue at hand? Yeah. This is the theory-based notion of argument quality within this taxonomy. And I claim in this talk that this view offers opportunities for advancing argument retrieval. And why is that so? So first of all, the view offers a holistic assessment of good arguments based on a theoretically grounded notion. So as I said, there are like more than 2,000 years of theory on what makes a good argument. And this is all incorporated within this taxonomy. And it's incorporated in a very structured way, which then allows for fine-grained assessment of the arguments. I also claim that the results of such a retrieval engine might be more interpretable. So I'm not referring to explaining how the internal model structure work, but if we just display the assessments of these different aspects of theory-based argument quality to a user, then the user can really see why was this argument retrieved. Maybe because it's particularly well arranged. Maybe it scores high in the logical perspective, and so on and so on. So this allows then the user to have more decision power about which arguments he or she or they chose. And then finally, this allows more potential, of course, then in turn for more focused and targeted retrieval. So the user might already, before the retrieval or before starting a query, decide in which types of arguments they might be interested in. And we might also relate this to user-specific properties. Okay, so this sounds great. We have a theory-based taxonomy of argument quality at hand. There are several opportunities for advancing argument retrieval, but where do we stand? Yeah, so in the follow-up work and within the work presenting the taxonomy, the authors said that this assessment is particularly challenging, which makes sense given all the properties and so on. But they also said that crowdsourcing is possible if the guidelines and the task are simplified. And when we started working on this topic, then we found that until last year, there was no larger scale corpus available and no computational models for doing theory-based argument quality assessment. In order to address this research gap, we then presented the Grammarly Argument Quality Corpus, which is the first multi-domain corpus and the largest English corpus available, annotated with theory-based argument quality scores. And to this end, we had to conduct the simplifications. So for instance, we reduced the taxonomy. We only kept overall argument quality and the three higher level dimensions, and we translated the lower level aspects to guiding questions. So binary questions, which inform the user or the annotator in that case, more about the decisions relating to the higher level dimensions, We also modified the instructions, so we simplified them, we added examples and so on. And from the original 3-point scale in the previous work, we moved to a 5-point scale because this allows for more nuanced judgments. And it has been shown in the literature that scales with 5 to 9 items are optimal for balancing the information need of the researcher and also the complexity of the task. We then conducted the annotations. And we conducted the annotations with 2 groups of annotators. We had expert annotators, which are all fluent or native in English and had all an advanced degree in linguistics. And we also wanted to see, can we crowdsource this in order to go large scale? We then conducted pilot studies. In total, we conducted 13 pilot studies. And we also developed an additional web interface, which helps the annotators to be guided through the process. And we also had to validate our simplifications, of course. And to this end, we sampled randomly 200 arguments from the corpus, which was presented in the previous work, where also the taxonomy was presented. And we also took crowdsourced annotations from previous work, which is the follow-up work of the similar group of authors. And then we also annotated the same arguments with our guidelines and our annotation interface, and we compared the agreements. And we found that we can significantly higher the inter-annotator agreement, which is shown here in terms of Krippendorf's alpha across all dimensions. We then went large scale. And as we really wanted to work with arguments as they are out there in the wild, we focused on 3 domains of online argumentative writing. First of all, debate forums, and in particular, the Reddit subforum Change My View, and the forum Convince Me. Then also community question and answering forums. In particular, here we looked at Yahoo Answers, the subjects on law and ethics. And as the most non-canonical form of arguments, we also included Yelp restaurants reviews. As a result, we have now a corpus which contains around 5,300 arguments spanning across 3 domains. And we also have several portions here. Some are annotated by the crowd only, some portion is annotated by the experts only, and some arguments are annotated by both experts and the crowds, allowing for advanced comparative studies with our corpus. And we also provide a standard split together with the corpus. And as you can see in the table, the CQA and the debates domains have all around 2,000 arguments, while the reviews domain is the smallest with around 1,000 arguments. And using this standard split, I then conducted experiments. And in particular, I first computed several baselines and a heuristic baseline, argument length, then several support vector regression models with lexical features, semantic features, and also I re-implemented a feature-rich approach from previous work, which uses sentiment features and also argumentative discourse unit flows and so on. And then, of course, we also went with a BERT-based encoding on which I placed on top a simple regression model. And here you can see the results for the 2 best performing models. And as we can see, the BERT model outperformed the feature-rich approach by a large margin. And it also validates that we are generally able to train computational models for theory-based argument quality assessment on that corpus. As the taxonomy suggests interrelationships between the different dimensions, we then also studied multitask learning approaches. And in particular, a flat multitask learning approach where we jointly predict overall argument quality and the 3 higher level dimensions, cogency, reasonableness, and effectiveness. And as a second approach, I studied a hierarchical model in which we first predict jointly the lower level dimensions, cogency, reasonableness, and effectiveness. And we then use the obtained predictions and concatenate them with a hidden document representation to inform the prediction of the overall argument quality. And this models the hierarchical structure of the taxonomy. And what we saw is that generally, the multitask learning models outperformed the single task model in 9 out of 12 cases. And for the multitask learning models, there was no clear conclusion on whether the hierarchical modeling helps, because sometimes it helped and sometimes not. But generally, this validated the assumption that there exists interrelationship between the different dimensions. So we have a corpus available and we have models available. But what challenges are we facing? Yeah, so we have a corpus available, first larger scale corpus. But this corpus only covers the four higher level dimensions, overall argument quality, cogency, effectiveness, and reasonableness. And it only covers three domains of argumentative writing, and it only covers English. So of course, one question is, do we want to build more resources? And if we do so, we need to consider more domains and languages, and what is about a finer grained assessment? And especially taking a more multilingual perspective is super important for providing inclusive computational argumentation technologies. Then secondly, intrinsically evaluating the quality makes sense. So just looking at the text and trying to assess whether it's a good argument. But we know that there is so much more to it. So for instance, there's a certain context in which the debate takes place. Maybe we want to include the cultural background, certain moral values. Maybe we want to include knowledge about the audience, because this perceived quality depends very much on, for instance, prior beliefs of the audience. Maybe we want to include knowledge about the speaker, because also, as Aristotle already noticed in his means of persuasion, the credibility of the speaker is very important, so the whole ethos of the speaker. And finally, in argumentation, background knowledge is super important. So common sense knowledge, word knowledge, and so on, in order to really assess whether the argument makes sense. And in order to better understand the role of knowledge in computational argumentation, we recently surveyed 162 papers in our field, and we were checking the approaches for the types of knowledge they include and how they include it. And in order to organize the results, we came up with the following knowledge pyramid, the argumentation knowledge pyramid, which has at the bottom linguistic knowledge as the most broadly included knowledge, then general knowledge, argumentation-specific knowledge, and finally task-specific knowledge. So the argumentation knowledge pyramid organizes the knowledge according to its specificity. Linguistic knowledge describes knowledge which is needed by almost all NLP models, for instance, word embeddings, traditional linguistic features, and so on. Then general knowledge is knowledge which is useful for many natural language understanding tasks, for instance, this common sense knowledge. Then argumentation-specific knowledge is knowledge that is important for most argumentation models, for instance, the argument structure, the sentiment of the argument, moral values, and so on. And task-specific knowledge is knowledge which is really useful for a particular target task. For instance, user-specific knowledge, such as, for instance, the audience information for argument quality. And as I said, we surveyed 162 papers, and for 40 of those, we really made an in-depth analysis of the types of knowledge used. And we found out that generally, task-specific knowledge and general knowledge is not often used. And this is also, of course, also specifically the case for argument assessment, which is the category under which argument quality falls. So as we can see, general knowledge, so common sense knowledge, moral knowledge is really underrepresented. And also the task-specific knowledge still offers a lot of potential, and especially in the case of argument quality assessment. So we need advanced knowledge, but where to obtain the information needed and how do we want to model it? And as the third challenge and the last challenge, ethics. So we know that argument retrieval influences people's opinions in the context of self-determined opinion formation systems, for instance. And if we guide argument retrieval with argument quality, and then, on the other hand, we also have evidence that argumentative corpora are biased. How can we ensure that the model's assessments are not unfairly biased and do not propagate stereotypical opinions and perpetuate unfair opinions? Yeah, and this is also very related to my current research within the context of the ESG Integrator project focusing on fairness. Okay, so to sum up, we have opportunities for advancing argument retrieval within the notion of theory-based argument quality. Why? Because it offers a holistic perspective, a theoretically grounded and structured view on the problem. It can lead to improved interpretability and then allow for more focused and targeted retrieval. What we currently have is we have data and computational models for three domains. For English, as I said, we have seen works, also other works than ours, on the intrinsic assessment of argument quality. But maybe we want to look at the problem for more domains. We want to be inclusive and include more languages. And maybe we also want to go on the finer grained aspect level, which we excluded in our work. And what about including advanced knowledge for our approaches? Where do we get the knowledge from? And finally, we have the issue of unfairness in natural language processing. And this, of course, also applies to the problem of assessing the argument quality of arguments for advancing argument retrieval. Okay, thank you very much for your interest. And I'm hoping that you got somehow interesting insights.